Good evening, friends. Good evening. Oh, good. My name's Karen Wood. I serve this learning community as a chaplain, and it's my pleasure to welcome you this evening to this evening's lecture by Professor Roberto Gonzalez of the Harvard University's Graduate School of Education. He will be sharing with us his research on undocumented young people as they navigate the path to school and work without the security of immigration documentation. This lecture is part of Willamette's larger Martin Luther King celebration, which begins today and continues for the next couple of weeks. So in addition to tonight's lecture, I'd like to draw your attention to the events on this little card that you should have received, and particularly to the Agents of Change documentary film and discussion on the 25th of January to Convocation, a shameless shout out for my own program, on Thursday at 11:30 to 12:30. And if you do not have tickets to Ta-Nehisi Coates, they are all gone, so I am sorry. And there's a long wait list, so I invite you to go online to The Atlantic and read his long-form journalism. Also, I want to invite you to stop by the Purple DACA letters table in the lobby out here. This is the Purple DACA Letters campaign, aims to create inclusion by raising awareness about the positive impact of undocumented youth in our local communities. So you can write a letter, you can get more information about them and their campaign. Also, convocation on February 2nd will be about sanctuary campuses and how people can be allies and strive to be allies and create a safe community for our students who are undocumented and their families. And finally, this is an annual exercise. I would like to acknowledge the Martin Luther King Jr. program and organizing committee that puts this event and many other events on every year. And Gordy Toyama, the director of the Office of Multicultural Affairs, this is a point where I ask them to stand up and they usually decline, but let me try again. Would the members of the committee please stand? Thank you, and thank you. This is the work of many, many months to put this program together, so we're grateful for their work, and we're grateful that you are here this evening. Martin Luther King framed his vision of what justice would look like by the phrase, the beloved community, a phrase that was coined by philosopher Josiah Royce and popularized by King. The beloved community is a society in which justice and freedom from oppression are the right of all people and are exercised by all people. Now, Professor Gonzalez's research reveals that no matter what the educational attainment or level of social belonging many undocumented young adults reach in our nation, they are eventually overtaken by the reality of the limits their immigration status imposes upon them. It becomes, as he puts it, the master status of their lives. As we gather tonight to learn more from Professor Gonzalez and to reflect on the impact of Dr. King's work on this nation, I invite you on this day in particular to hold fast to this vision of a beloved community, not as an ideal that's unattainable, but rather as a goal towards which we continue to work, all of us, so that all those who are currently prevented from full expression of their beauty and possibility, and so that all those who are at risk, emotionally, physically, legally, may live lives in which freedom from fear, expectation of respect, and the right to dream with confidence constitute their master status. So with that in mind, I invite you to welcome Professor Michael Nino of the Sociology Department, and he will introduce our speaker. Thank you.
Okay. So good evening, and welcome to tonight's event. Before we get started, I'd really like to thank a few people that have helped put this together. First, I'd like to thank all of the wonderful students, staff, and faculty that have helped put all today's events together. We definitely could not have done this without you. I'd also like to thank all of the different departments that helped co-sponsor the event. That includes American Ethnic Studies, Women's and Gender Studies, Sociology, Spanish, Anthropology, Politics, and Economics. And I'd also like to thank Gordy Toyama and Karen Wood, not only for their work related to the Martin Luther King celebration, but also for all the important work and support they provide to so many of us here on this campus. You truly make Willamette a better place, and so thank you for all the work that you do for us. And so now it's my distinct honor to introduce you to our speaker tonight, Dr. Roberto Gonzalez. Dr. Gonzalez is an assistant professor at Harvard University's Graduate School of Education. Prior to his faculty position at Harvard, Gonzalez held positions at the University of Chicago and the University of Washington. Professor Gonzalez is a product of the liberal arts, attending and graduating from Colorado College with a bachelor's degree in sociology. He then went to go work in the community in Chicago, working in community work, and also earned a master's degree from the School of Social Service Administration at the University of Chicago. After that, he then went on to earn a master's and doctoral degree in sociology from the University of California, Irvine. Over the last decade and a half, Dr. Gonzalez's research has critically explored what happens to undocumented immigrant children as they transition from adolescence to young adulthood. Many argue, which I would agree with, that Dr. Gonzalez has carried out the most comprehensive study on undocumented immigrants in the United States. Dr. Gonzalez's work has been featured in top social science journals, including the American Sociological Review, Current Anthropology, and the Harvard Educational Review. His research has been featured in a number of prominent news outlets, including the New York Times, Washington Post, Los Angeles Times, Wall Street Journal, Time Magazine, U.S. News and World Report, and the Chronicle of Higher Education. His work has received a number of awards from the American Sociological Association, National Academy of Sciences, and the American Educational Research Association. Most recently, and I mean like 2 weeks ago, Rick Hess at Education Week named Dr. Gonzalez the top junior education scholar for 2017. I'm truly grateful that Professor Gonzalez has agreed to come spend some time with us tonight. Dr. Gonzalez's work is truly groundbreaking, changing the way that we think about how education, schools, immigration policy, and time influences the lives of those who are often forced to live in the shadows. I'm confident that his work will help shape the work that we do here at Willamette for many years to come. So please join me in welcoming our speaker for tonight, Dr. Roberto Gonzalez.
Thank you, Michael, for the kind introduction. Thanks also to Gordy Toyama and to Karen Wood for the invitation. Thank you all for coming out tonight, and thank you all to the students here. I've had a really terrific day. I want to remark first what a gorgeous room we're in. So I grew up in a working class family, and now that I'm, I teach at a place like Harvard, it's not lost on me the spaces that I can be in, that I can enter, that I move within, that for many of my family members, these spaces they will never enter. So it's one of my favorite things about doing what I do. Kind of a side thing, is just really just appreciating the space. So I want to dedicate this talk to children and to young people. On this day especially, I think about Gordy's daughter Carly, who wrote me a very, very sincere letter tonight. I think about my son Joaquin Tomas, who's 3 years old. And I think about our students, our daughters and sons. I think about our nephews and nieces, and I think about the young people in this country collectively and their future. One of my students today posted on Facebook, and I just wanted to share a very short quote from her, Amanda Klonsky. She lives in Chicago. She's a doctoral student of mine. She says that our daughters and sons are watching us, and they're learning from us that it is our collective duty to stand up for justice and to care for others. Every choice we make in this time is modeling for our kids how to live the values of peace, justice, equality, anti-racism, and love for the earth. I couldn't agree more. So I'm really, really pleased to share with you tonight my work, the work that went into this book, but more broadly, I think about a longer arc, arc of the last 24 years that I've been thinking about this broad question of what happens to undocumented kids as they come of age. So this is really last 14 years as a scholar, but 10 years before, 10 years right after college, I lived in Chicago and I worked with youth for a number of years. So literally I moved there from college and my first job I lived a half a block, I lived down the alley from a community center where I worked. And then lived four blocks away. So for almost 10 years, I lived and worked in the same Chicago community. And working with kids and families, I got a real worm's eye view of the ways in which larger processes, immigration, education, policing, gentrification, how these larger processes frame the everyday worlds of kids and families. So over the years and working with families, largely immigrant families in this community, I got to see really up close the ways that some of these issues were affecting them. Many of my coworkers were working in very progressive movements for the undocumented workers, thinking about the parents of these kids that I want to talk about tonight. And really thinking about their plight and that they're really framing their lives, their circumstances around human rights, right? So framing this work around human rights. But surprisingly for me, very little was known about children, about their children. But nevertheless, here I was seeing many of them over the years, right, in my programs, many of them coming of age. And so for many of them, many of these kids in our neighborhood, as they hit their 8th grade, 9th grade, 10th grade years, as their friends were moving forward, getting driver's licenses, getting after school jobs, thinking about college, getting financial aid for college, as friends were moving forward into these very defining American rites of passage, many of the young people that I was working with had no real choice but to stand aside and watch while their friends move forward. Fast forward a few years and I find myself in California. I guess I did more than find myself. I moved to California to start a graduate program. And in Southern California, I'm hanging out in cities like Santa Ana and Anaheim in Long Beach and Los Angeles, and meeting many young people with very similar stories. Had come to the U.S. at 6 months old, at 5 years old, 7 years old, had grown up side by side with American-born friends and peers. But again, at this critical time, at around 14, 15, 16 years old, as their friends moved forward, they were not able to join their friends. And many of their teachers, their counselors, adults in their lives were powerless to do anything to help them. So this starts what becomes a 12-year-long inquiry into this broad question that I frame this talk in. what happens to these young people as they make critical transitions through adolescence and young adulthood. So let me start there. Michael mentioned that time is a very, very central to this work, and time in this story is indeed a very central character. Right? We listen to policymakers, to our politicians, who tell us that change takes time. Certainly, if we look historically, any progressive change in this country has taken years, if not decades. Right? And they tell us that policymaking is an incremental process. Right? All of these things are true, but these ideas don't square with the everyday lives of kids and their families, right, who are tasked every day to try to eke out a living, to try to live with dignity, to try to get home safely every day, right? To try to aspire and try to work hard, right? Against, for many of them, oftentimes, very steep barriers. For those paying attention to the immigration debate over the last several years, immigration in this country is characterized by congressional inaction. Right? Our Congress has really not been able to get its act together in moving an immigration bill forward. Right? But in the meantime, what we've had is what political scientist Gary Segura has called enforcement on steroids. Under the Obama administration alone, close to 3 million people have been removed from this country. Right? But meanwhile, I remind us, the kids and their families like this one right here, right, have no choice but to wait. In my book, I argue that illegality is a master status. So this master status term is an old sociological concept that refers to a particular trait, right, that overwhelms or dominates other traits. Right? People tend to think about race, about gender as master statuses. Right? To put in more plain terms, in more simple terms, master status is like a binding constraint, a lead weight, if you will, that eventually drags you down. So for many of the young people that I talk to, no matter what their initial advantages might have been in school, no matter how quickly they may have come out of the gate, right, their immigration status in some way or another, in many ways, dragged them down. So let me put this into context, a little bit of context so we can kind of understand the national picture. Right. So we hear talk radio often inflates the number. There are 20 million people, there are 30 million people in this country. The best estimates that we have place this number at around 11.2, 11.3 million people in this country living in an undocumented residency status. So I want to say that very long kind of term, undocumented residency status. I'll use shorthand later or after that. But I want to make one point crystal clear, is that this is not natural, right? These people aren't born this way, right? This is a result of policies, right? Oftentimes at this number also, we talk about the X million number of undocumented workers. We often refer to this population as undocumented workers, like my coworkers back in Chicago. Right? We're thinking about undocumented workers, really important population. But it's critical to know that a sizable segment of this population has been here since childhood. Right? Grow up in communities and are schooled in our local schools. Right? But this is a population that has grown dramatically over the last several decades. Right? And this growth right, is largely a result of our border policies and the unintended consequences of our border policies. So beginning in the late 1980s, we started investing billions of dollars in our border policies, right, to build longer and taller fences, longer, taller, and thicker fences, to put more agents on the border, right, and to increases in surveillance technology. If anybody's been to the southern border lately, right, I would not be surprised if you saw drones patrolling our southern border. Right? So this beef up of the border, right, has made crossing much more difficult, much more costly, and a lot more dangerous. Right? And this is critical to know. Why? Because prior to the late 1980s, many migrants left their families of origin at their homes, left their families in their countries of origin, right? Left their spouses and their children in their countries of origin, right? And they would come up to the U.S., work for a few months at a time, and then go back home. And so they'd repeat this cycle, right? But what happens when it becomes a lot more expensive, a lot more costly, and a lot more dangerous to cross? Instead of making this treacherous trip back and forth, isn't migrants sent for their families? Right? So what we have accelerating in the late 1980s through the 1990s, right, is a large number of migrants, right, who are permanent settlers, and a very significant, sizable number of children who will make their home in the United States, who will grow up in the United States without legal status. For these kids, here's the dilemma, the chief dilemma for these kids. In 1982, our Supreme Court ruled in Plyler versus Doe that states could not deny undocumented children access to a K-12 education. So as a result of Plyler, tens of thousands of undocumented children graduate from our public schools every year. Right? Plyler provided a big boost to these kids. Plyler's reach was really limited, though, in that Plyler did not address life outside of school, and it did not address school beyond K-12 education. Right? So while undocumented kids can go to school, right, can't work legally, can't drive in most states, can be deported at any time. Right? So our laws treat children and adults differently, but don't account for the continuity of children becoming adults. Right? To paraphrase, I think it's Neil Sedaka, who's saying breaking up is hard to do. For these kids, growing up is hard to do. Right? So as these children make these critical transitions to adolescence and young adulthood, they move from a protected status to an unprotected status, right? From an inclusion to an exclusion, from de facto legal to quote unquote illegal in the pejorative. Right? So I want to share with you some of what I learned in this long-term study, 12-year study in Los Angeles, where I followed 150 young people over these 12 years. I followed about half of those were really high achievers, had at least 2 years of college. By the end of the study, most of them had graduated from college, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, and a sizable segment had gone on and gotten post-baccalaureate degrees. And the other half are, I call them early exiters, young people who left the school system at or before their high school graduation. Right? So two very different groups of young people. And I follow these young people over this time. So I want to turn to some of the interviews that I did, and while I can't really play the recordings of their voices, I do want to bring these young people into this presentation. So Rudy, as his friends called him. I met Rudy very early in my study, and Rudy's talking about this awakening. And he tells me, he says, well, you know what? I never actually felt like I wasn't born here. Because when I came here, I was like 10 and a half. I went to school, I learned the language. But I first felt like I was really out of place when I tried to get a job, when I graduated from high school and I tried to get a job. And I asked, why was that? He says, well, because I didn't have a Social Security number. Well, I didn't even know. I mean, I didn't even know what that meant. You know, Social Security, legal, illegal. I didn't even know what that was. I asked my mom, and she said, it's in the process. In the process, I didn't even know what that meant. I don't know why she would tell us that. So this awakening that Rudy very aptly described as an awakening to a nightmare, right? I heard this story over and over and over as I talked to young people. Many of them had a very similar story. So for some of them, right, because childhood didn't pose any challenges to their legality, they weren't pressed to provide their birth certificate, their Social Security number, to do most activities in childhood, many of them didn't even know about their status. They didn't know about their undocumented status. Others told me that they knew early on that their parents had told them, and they certainly knew about their parents' circumstances. They knew more philosophically about their own status, but it wasn't until this knowledge was matched up with experiences of exclusion that it became very salient to them in their lives, right? Moving forward with Rudy again, Rudy tells me, he says, but when I actually wanted to get a job, I couldn't. I couldn't because I didn't have the Social Security number. So my first job was cleaning carpets, helping out my dad. So you look at Rudy and other young people that I talk to, right, is that Rudy looks at his family and he sees that he speaks English with much greater fluency, that he has outpaced his parents in terms of his education, right? But here he is with the same very limited range of job choices, right? For his parents came to the United States so their kids could have a better life. And it's really destabilizing for many families to see their kids, right, for parents to see their kids with such limited options for their future. Here's Sergio. Sergio, I think I met my first week of graduate school. And I want to trace his story later on in the talk. But Sergio told me the story of this 1957 Chevy that he wanted to buy. So a retired postal carrier in his neighborhood had this car sitting in his driveway. Sergio really wanted the car. So he pestered this gentleman over and over and over. I want this car. How can I buy your car? What will you sell this to me? So this person says, you know, look, if this will get you off my back, I'll sell you this car for $5,000. This is not a cherry 1957 Chevy by any means. This is pretty beat up. This car has seen its day. I'll sell you this car for $5,000. Come up with half of this money as a down payment, and then we can talk. So what does Sergio do? He saves his money. He gets paper routes, he takes side jobs, teenage kind of side jobs kind of things. He saves up almost half. He's a little south of $2,000, and he approaches this person. He says, I'm gonna go get my license, and you know, let's talk about this car. So he goes to the DMV and he is informed that he can't get a driver's license. So here, you know, his whole hopes were this car and all the plans that he had made. He had seen himself driving this car, maybe putting some dice up on the car. He told me, he said, that really sucked. I had been all like, I'm going to get my car before all of you to his friends, but I couldn't. It was unfair, and I had to, you know, what could I do? How could I tell them that I can't drive? I can't get my license. It really messed me up. So Sergio's really colloquial, that really sucked. It really messed me up, very powerfully underscore, right, this feeling, this really stinging feeling, right, that Rudy, Sergio, and others felt as though when they thought they were moving forward, they thought they were going one direction in their lives, and then suddenly they hit this wall. But they also hit this wall, as I mentioned before, while their friends were moving forward, right? And so many of these stories that I've told so far are stories that are probably not unfamiliar to you all. And I think that over the years, we've heard several of these stories by our elected officials. We've read about them in our local newspapers. Many of us know young people, right, in this situation who've been denied, who've hit these barriers. What's less talked about is the stigma. Right? So what I mean by this is that as these young people are coming of age into this status, they're also coming into a growing awareness of what this identity means for them as young people in this society. Right? And the ways in which talk radio, our elected officials, disparage people with this status, right? And so for many of these young people, many of the young people that I met ended up keeping this a secret. This is their big secret that they kept from their friends, they kept from teachers, and in many cases also kept from their romantic partners. But how many of us have kept secrets in our lives, right? Is the secret then, right? It eats up everything, right? It touches everything. You try to keep a secret and it affects other things in your life, right? And so for many of these young people, right, the secret, keeping the secret then caused them to disassociate from their friends, from really critical networks of support that they'd grown up with. So here's Grace talking about it. She says, I just stopped going out. I was tired of asking for a ride and coming up with excuses. And every time it was a hassle with my friends. So I started telling them I was too busy with school. At first they didn't like that, but after a while they stopped inviting me. She said, I ended up spending a lot of weekends by myself because most of my friends don't call me anymore. It's such a hassle to explain everything to people. And it's affected the way I am when I meet new people. She said, I used to be very outgoing, but now I try to keep my guard up. I try not to get too close to people. So what this was, right, for many of these young people, is this constant chain of explanations. So explaining to friends why in Los Angeles you're taking the bus, right, where going 7 miles may take you 2.5 hours and 3 bus transfers, right? Why, as the salutatorian of your class, you're taking a gap year or not going to college at all? What is that, Donald Duck? No, it's okay. I'm just concerned. So for many of these people, this stigma management, right, serves as a secondary border. I'm not sure why I always do the discount double check move. but serves as a secondary border that reinforces these legal exclusions. Young people here are opting out, right? Opting out from activities, disassociating themselves from friends, severing themselves from critical support networks. So Grace, I ran into Grace about a month after I did her first interview. I ran into her at her college campus. Grace was a health promoter in her community, and whenever I saw Grace prior to this, she carried herself like an executive director of a community agency. She's always dressed very nicely, always presented herself very professionally. When I saw her that day on her college campus, it was clear to me that something was wrong. It looked like she had been crying. It looked like she hadn't slept in days. She looked really, really distraught. So I asked her if she wanted to sit down, and we went to a cafe. And she explained to me that she had broken up with her boyfriend. They had been together for about a year prior to that. And she told me that she had come very close to disclosing her status to her boyfriend. But there was something about the situation that she didn't feel completely safe. Nevertheless, this was the person that she was the closest with in her world at this time, was her boyfriend. They spent a lot of time together. They were both pre-med majors in school, and they shared their hopes and their dreams with each other. She told me that they were eating breakfast together on a weekend at the boyfriend's apartment. TV's on in the background, and a news segment on immigration comes on the TV. And her boyfriend starts yelling at those damned illegal Mexicans. They need to send them all back. So you can imagine, Grace didn't say anything, but she was devastated. She told me the next day that she called her boyfriend and she explained to him that she couldn't continue in a relationship because she was too busy with work and school and she couldn't balance a relationship. She was devastated, but she had to swallow disappointment and she had to move on with her life. I was sharing with students earlier today, perhaps the biggest surprise for me in this work early on, so I'm not a psychologist. I can't give diagnoses. I'm a sociologist, and I was really interested in mobility pathways of these young people, educational and occupational trajectories over time. What I didn't expect to find, but to the person of those young people that I talked to, they all described physical and emotional manifestations of stress. Chronic headaches, toothaches, ulcers, trouble sleeping, problems getting out of bed in the morning, eating problems, thoughts of suicide, attempted suicide. It became very clear to me after a while, after listening to these stories, there's a very strong link between their undocumented status and their well-being. Here's a young man named Misto. Misto told me, he says, yeah, I think about it a lot, about his status. He says, I'm always thinking about it. What happens if I get picked up? What if my boss finds out? I get dizzy a lot and my stomach is always hurting. My mom says I have an ulcer. So let me graphically represent what we've been talking about. Right? What I describe as a transition to illegality. Right? So moving from a protected status to all of these really important defining rites of passage, waking up to a nightmare, succession of blocked opportunities, fear, stigma, changed social patterns, physical and emotional manifestations of stress. So over time, and this for me is the, I don't want to say beauty. Beauty almost sounds really cruel to coin it as beauty, but really the value of longitudinal research. As I was able to follow these young people several years out, many of them into their 30s, right? And I mentioned that I had followed a group of very high achievers and more modestly achieving young people, college goers and early exiters. Certainly early transitions out of high school, college goers shot up. Right? They joined college campuses like this one. They joined their peers in legally permissible activity. They were excited, they're happy, spent time in beautiful settings like this one, and felt really, really great about themselves, about their future, felt a strong sense of belonging on their college campuses. Early Exeters, on the other hand, at 16, 17, 18 years old, left school to a world of limitations and low-wage work, where every day they're confronted by the limitations of their status. But by their mid-20s, as the college-goers ran out of school, so many of them, several dozen of the college-goers, finished college with degrees, right? Significant segment of that population went on to post-baccalaureate degrees, masters in social work, in public policy, in planning, in education, a couple with JDs in law. Right? But as of 2012, none of them were in a career pathway that matched their educational experience or their educational credentials. Their trajectories began to converge, right? Such that college-goers found themselves with the same very, very limited range of opportunities, right, as the early Exeters. And so I want to talk about Esperanza. And Esperanza, for those Spanish speakers in the room, the pseudonym that I give her, Esperanza, Spanish meaning hope, is not without irony. Here's a conversation that I had with Esperanza. She's a few years out of college. So Esperanza had graduated from a very prestigious University of California campus. But in the years following, she realized that she had little choice but to help out her family. She wanted to help out her family. She also wanted to be able to date. She also wanted to have some independence. Right, so she ends up taking jobs. Right, in college, she tried really hard not to work, not to drive, but over time, right, she had very little choice. Right, what else is she going to do? Sit on the couch all the time? Right, as a young woman. So, she's talking about her experience in low-wage jobs. She says the people working at those places, like the cooks and the cashiers, they're all really young and I feel really old. Like, what am I doing there if they're like 16, 17 years old? The others are like señoras who are 35. They dropped out of school, but because they have kids, they're still working at the restaurant. Thinking about that, it makes me feel so stupid. And the factories too, they ask me, ¿Qué estás haciendo aquí? What are you doing here? You can speak English. You graduated from high school. You can work anywhere. Esperanza told me that the jobs that she takes, when she fills out applications, she leaves off her college education. Her biggest accomplishment to date, right, that makes her parents so proud, right, that she leaves it off because she says she doesn't believe that she'll be competitive for those jobs. She believes that the employers will overlook her application. So, in 2012, President Obama announced a Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program. Right? A program, a temporary and partial measure to provide access to undocumented young people like the ones that we've been talking about. Right? So DACA, for a $465 fee, DACA beneficiaries are able to receive a temporary Social Security number, a renewable work authorization, right, and a two-year stay of deportation. Several states have passed many state laws. Now in every state, DACA beneficiaries can apply for a driver's license. Right? And so in a very short time, right, hundreds of thousands of young people, and it's these numbers are slightly dated. About 740,000 young people have DACA now, and more than 500,000 have gone through the renewal process. Estimated population that's a little under 2 million. Right. Shortly after DACA, in what is a follow-up to the LA study, I put together a team, and we were lucky enough to get external funding for a national study on DACA. So in 2013, we surveyed about 2,700 DACA-eligible young adults, and we have followed it up. We've done two waves of in-depth interviews with DACA beneficiaries in Phoenix, in Los Angeles, in Atlanta, New York, Chicago, and Greenville, Columbia, South Carolina. And so I want to talk about that project. In the short term, it cannot be underscored enough that DACA has provided its beneficiaries a giant step towards the American mainstream. So we surveyed them 16 months after the implementation, the initiation of DACA. And it's overwhelming that these young people were getting new jobs, increasing their earnings, getting paid internships, getting driver's licenses, getting health care, building credit through credit cards, bank accounts, right? Taking giant steps for not only them, but also for their families. Right? A vast majority of our respondents told us that their family could benefit from immigration reform, meaning that somebody in their family was also undocumented. But more than 50% of them worried about deportation of a family member most of the time to all the time. And a staggering 70%, this is 2,700 young people, 70% of them said that they knew somebody in their life, a close family member, a relative, a friend, a coworker, a neighbor. 70% of them knew somebody who had been deported over the last several years. I would want to turn to the interviews. Essentially, through these interviews, almost 500 interviews, and we've done two waves of these interviews, we really wanted to know how these young people were experiencing their DACA status post-high school, and we were also interested in the ways in which the local context, right, was mediating their DACA status. So what does it mean to live in rural Georgia, for example, versus living in a place like Chicago or New York. My LA study was me, myself, and I carrying out the work over a number of years. This DACA study has been a huge effort. So we've got a team of about 65 people. More than half of our interviews have a DACA status, half of our interviewers, rather. We've got six teams out in the field. We've got a team of researchers at Harvard. We've got outreach people, and we've got field people who are training our teams. First wave, we did about 9 months of data collection. We outreached to organizations within the community. We're really also really proud of this, that we've made partnerships with about 74 organizations in our sites. So let me go through some of these kind of key findings. For many of the young people that we talked to, they told us that DACA was lifting their hopes. Lee from Phoenix told us that he said it gave me hope that my future is not up in the air anymore. Many others told us that this program and this status was improving their opportunities. Linda from Chicago, who's in a medical program, told us without DACA, med school could not provide an opportunity because they can't invest in a person that they know won't be able to work. DACA has expanded my opportunities, importantly. with these new opportunities, for many of them grows a sense of belonging. Jenny from Phoenix told us, I feel like it saved my life. Right? Powerful words. Many of the young people provided nuanced articulations of their identity. What does it mean? Am I documented? Am I still undocumented? What really does this status mean? And for many of them, they really asserted that it really proves that I am someone. Mighty Vale says, I've gone through some process to say that I have some sort of documentation to stay in this country. Jin said, it's just being able to identify yourself as someone. I am DACA, right? I have DACA. Maybe it's not full citizenship or full documentation, but it is something, right? Importantly, it is something. Many of the young people use their DACA status and their work authorization to help out their family members. Amelie from Phoenix says that that's probably the best thing, aside from being able to go to school, knowing that if my mom needs money, that I can help her, right? That I'm in a position to help my family. Sandra, who has kids of her own, talked about her oldest one. He said, my oldest one, he would get really scared when he saw the news and they're taking people away, right? That immigration agents are deporting people. When I got my DACA, I showed my son, I'm going to be okay. For others, they felt like they're, well, maybe I'm somewhere in the middle. I'm like, there's no legal, there's no name for it. Well, obviously it's DACA, but it's not like I can say, well, it's confusing to explain what it is because of its limits. Right? So many people felt still in limbo, that this status didn't reconcile this limbo that they felt. Carla told us that Carla from South Carolina told us that she's still trying to figure it out. She says, I don't know, I'm still trying to figure that out. What I am, as far as I am, it's confusing. Right? Nevertheless, many of the young people that we talked to continued to feel stress and to feel fear. Angela from Atlanta said, well, I'm always scared. What if my mother gets deported out of nowhere? What if my older sister doesn't fix her status? What's going to happen with her daughters? How's my brother-in-law going to take care of things? And how's he going to handle it? They're very close. They live together. It's a lot. There's still a lot of fear in my family. So for many young people, right, this really underscores a really important point, right, is that these young people don't live in a vacuum, don't live their lives in isolation. They're part of families and communities, right? That's in dire need of relief. And here's Eddie, and just reading this quote stresses me out. Eddie from Phoenix, he says, I try not to think about it, about deportation. He says, when it does happen, like saying I'm driving fine, driving the speed limit, hands on the wheel, 10 and 2. Then I see a cop behind me. I think, was I speeding? Was I going 5 above the speed limit? Did I turn? When I turn, did I use a turn signal right? Is he looking at me? Is he looking at my skin? I think, am I going to get deported if I get stopped? Am I going to jail and then get deported? Or are they going to send me far away? Oh, sorry. Am I going to go? If I do get deported, am I going to get deported to where I live or where I used to live? Or are they going to send me far away? They're going to be like, oh, he lives over here. Let's send him over there. If he does stop me, is he going to take my car away? Where's it going to go? My mom, how are they going to get help? All of that goes through my head. That's a lot. It affects me mentally, physically, and emotionally, I bet. Right? Again, just reading this, every time I read this, I get really stressed out. And these, for this young person, right, who has a driver's license, right, but is still living in a form of post-traumatic stress, right? For many of them, right, it's what Father Mike Flager from Chicago calls present traumatic stress, right? Constant, it's present. Right? I mentioned before that DACA is temporary and partial, and I want to address the future in a couple minutes. But for many DACA beneficiaries, many of them have already experienced the revocable nature of this status. Several months ago, USCIS was late in processing several hundred applications. And several hundred DACA beneficiaries who were renewing their status, who had turned in their paperwork on time, found themselves in a legal limbo when their window ran out, their DACA expired, and they hadn't yet heard from USCIS about their renewal. I'm working with a group of documented teachers, and many of them had to leave the classroom. Right? Many of them, many of these documented teachers, have felt it important for them to disclose their status to their students as a way for their students to, as a way to bond with their students in the communities where they work. For many of these students who've seen raids in their community, who've seen family members taken away, right, having their teachers plucked from their classrooms, right, was another traumatic incident, right, in their lives. So here's Lee in Phoenix explaining this, him going out of status. He said, "I just don't understand. I sent the renewal application in on time. I've been told there's the system is backed up and they're not processing applications on time. I don't know. I did what I was supposed to do, but I had to wait like almost 3 months, and in that time, I was what they call out of status. It really put me right back where I was before. It was that slap in the face reminder that I'm still undocumented. I'm still vulnerable. I could be arrested and deported like that. It really brought me down." All right? So for many of these young people, this is a very, very traumatic reminder, right, of the fragility, right, of this partial status. So I want to wrap up with two stories, Esperanza and Sergio. And first, Sergio. Remember Sergio? 1957 Chevy? So I met Sergio, he was about 20 years old. When I met him, he was in a continuing education program nearby his home. And he was doing really well making up credits. People are not familiar with this system. It's very different than high school in that you work independently through packets and you try to make up credits. He was doing really well. He was making really great progress, and the people at the community center where this continuation school was housed, they were very confident in Sergio. They were really cheering him on, and they saw him really getting his life back on track after having left high school. He wasn't working because, remember, Rudy said something about in the process, right? So many of the young people that I talked to, their families believed, many of them actually were in some sort of process and a process to adjust their status, either through somebody in their family who had legal papers, through a marriage or a remarriage, right? But there was a group of them that believed they were in the process, but weren't at all, and this was Sergio's case. So his mother had remarried a green card holder, a lawful permanent resident, and he wanted to adjust his wife's status as well as her children. So they went to a notary public in the community. This person told them he was an attorney, represented himself as an attorney, and over the months and years kept asking for sums of money. "I need $2,000 to fill out this paperwork. I need another $5,000 to do this." Ultimately, though, there was no process for them, and this person had taken large sums of money from them. But because Sergio thought that he was in a process, he wanted to play it safe. He wanted to play it safe, so he didn't drive, and he worked only on weekends. He worked on weekends setting up bounce houses. People know bounce houses, birthday parties. He got paid cash. He set them up, and he helped take them down. Wife felt that was safe. It was not a regular job. He was getting paid cash. Fast forward a couple of years, and Sergio meets somebody, a young woman. He falls in love, and they ultimately have a child together. He wants to be more responsible for his partner and for his child. So he takes a job. Takes a job in an assembly plant and meets a coworker who lives not too far from him. So he's getting a ride. He's carpooling with a coworker so he doesn't have to drive. His coworker, this white skinhead guy with a tattoo on the crown of his head, is the kind of person that police typically profile. So one evening after work, they were driving home and the police pulled them over. As the police officer was talking to them, he noticed there was marijuana paraphernalia in the car, a bong. So he asked the two young men to get out of the car, and he tossed the car. Him and his partner tossed the car. They found a pipe bomb in the car. So explosives. Under the Federal Patriot Act, even though Sergio had no clue that this was in the car, Sergio was charged as an accomplice, right, for a federal crime. So he does 3 years in prison, and then is deported. He's deported to Tijuana. He doesn't have money. His family doesn't have money to bring him back. He lives for several years in Tijuana, homeless at times, taking odd jobs. Other jobs that he hasn't talked with me about, and somehow gets back. I don't know the story around getting back. He has not told me how he got back. He gets back to California. He's living with his family. He's got a job, and he walks to work. As a deportee, if he is caught, he faces a mandatory 10 to 15 years in prison. So he is back playing it safe. His world has become very, very small. Esperanza gets DACA. She gets DACA. She's 31 years old. She gets DACA. She tells me that at 30, that she had planned to join her mother and her sisters in Milwaukee for a year, and that she was going to move to Canada after that. And then DACA is announced. And she tells me, she says, you know, you have no idea how thankful I felt that I got included into that. I remember the day I logged onto Facebook at the library and my friend messaged me, and she congratulated me on barely making it. She sent me the memo to make me believe it. And when Obama finally made the announcement, after taking forever, I was watching still incredulous that I had made it in. Right? This for her is like manna from heaven. Right? It's her chance, it's her break. Right? After all of these years of struggle, right, here this is, and she's ready to make the most of it. Esperanza, as I mentioned before, since she got out of college, she started working. And so she had been working for several years by this time. Restaurants, factories, call centers. Right? She had a lot of work experience. She had a college degree, and she wanted something that matched her college degree, but she realized that she had no experience in those job sectors where she wanted a job. Right? She had graduated from a very prestigious University of California campus, but she had a very thin resume. So she tells me, she said, I learned that recruiters do not look for potential when hiring, but for work experience and previous job length. They ask situational questions about your last job that prove your capabilities. Right? Esperanza is still living in Milwaukee, and she balances a hotel job with a part-time dog walking job with some other odd jobs. So I end here. Thank you for your patience. My wife teases me that I talk a lot and I talk really slowly, so I really appreciate your patience. So I stop here, and these are, I think, two important chapters. Right? This LA study and this DACA study, two important chapters in this larger story about the lives of these young people who live and work in our communities. There have been many rumors based on our new president's campaign promises that DACA could end as soon as today. Just as a couple days ago, there were many rumors going around that he would sign an executive order today eliminating DACA. I haven't heard that's happened. It may or may not happen next week. But many of the young people that I've talked to, many of the young people in our study, many of the young people that I've talked to on my campus, I've gotten many texts, Facebook messages, emails, calls from young people who are worried. I talked about the transition to illegality earlier in my LA study, and I think that there's real concrete evidence, right, that DACA in some really important ways has slowed down that transition. Right? So 740,000 young people now have this status. And so what do we do going forward? So what is the future of this program? What is the future of these young people and their families? This is a story that's to be continued. I've been heartened today by the interactions that I've had with students, with staff and faculty here on campus. And really the spirit of, I think, real love for justice, a distaste for injustice, and people ready to mobilize, ready to push back. So time will tell, to be continued, but I believe that there's a strong countercurrent. I'm happy to take questions. I'm happy to learn from you all. But first, let me say again, thank you very much.